You're watching Reality Check. In the past 24 hours, at least one person has been killed, a BJP worker, and many injured in clashes in Kerala between the BJP and right-wing groups versus the left, as well as versus the police, over the entry of women, finally, into the Sabarimala temple. One of the uglier aspects of this violence and turmoil that has engulfed Kerala is that it has exposed the clear double standards of at least two of our national parties and possibly revealed opportunism by a third. Now, just look at the shifting stance taken by the Congress to begin with. First, making pro-women entry statements, like saying they welcome the historic judgment of the Supreme Court which allowed the entry of women into Sabarimala. Then Randeep Surjewala's spokesperson saying there can be no discrimination on the ground of gender or sex as per India's constitution. And then the questioning starts. Shashi Tharoor, most recently, saying that the entry of women into Sabarimala is an unnecessary provocative act.
Congress in Kerala has always taken the view that we must stand with the believers, because the believers in Kerala are the overwhelming majority, and they have very strong views about the arrangements at Sabarimala and the practices that have been followed for hundreds of years. And for this reason, they wanted the Supreme Court to review its decision, and that's happening on the 22nd of January. People should have waited till then.
Then we have Mr. Ramesh Chennithala, also of the Kerala Congress, saying the Chief Minister, who is hell-bent on defying rituals and beliefs of Sabarimala, has hurt the sentiments of millions of devotees. K. Sudhakaran, another Congress leader, if the Congress party does not stand with the devotees on the temple issue, the party will be decimated. And finally, Rahul Gandhi weighing in, saying, my opinion is that women are equal and should be allowed into the temple, but my party unit in Kerala has a different view. I'm going with the party. Here's the BJP's doublespeak. First, on triple talaq, the Prime Minister saying triple talaq is not a religious issue, it's about gender justice. Arun Jaitley saying the judgment is a victory for all those who believed personal laws must also be progressive and compliant with constitutional guarantees. Amit Shah saying that the triple talaq bill is a historic step ensuring the equality and dignity for Muslim women. But on Sabarimala, the Prime Minister. Every temple has their own beliefs. There are temples where men are not allowed. Mr. Jaitley, the constitutionalists believe that first there is the Supreme Court and thereafter there is God, but devotees feel otherwise. There will always be a grey area and the reconciliation will always be a challenge. Amit Shah, I hereby warn the left government not to misuse the Sabarimala issue, otherwise we know how to give a fitting response. Okay, so across the board there, parties with their shifting stance. Let's just go across now to our panel, but let me go across first exclusively to Thomas Isaac, Finance Minister of Kerala, who joins me live from Trivandrum. Mr. Isaac, thank you very much for joining us. Now, we've seen a lot of violence in Kerala today, very unfortunate, but one of the things that the BJP and now even the Congress is accusing your government of is that this is because of a reckless and irresponsible staging of the entry into the temple of these women that you did, that the government, in effect, staged the entry of these women, and that's why they're so provoked.
It's astonishing remark to come from Congress. But I cannot be more surprised, because even a person like Shashi Tharoor, this is the biggest disappointment. Even despite my political difference with him, I have always considered him frank and modern. But here, I just heard him now. They are with the believers. Hmm. There are two types of believers. Believers right. Who believe that tradition don't want women to enter. And there are people, believers, who think the women have equal right to enter. Nitya Chaitanya Yadi. The greatest sage Kerala has seen since Sri Narayana Guru.
Right.
He, in 1991, after the High Court verdict, he wrote a long article asking women to defy and enter the temple. And so the question is, which type of believers are you? Are you going to stick with the tradition or are you going to take them forward? Hmm. Now look at the opposition leader.
Yes.
He has not a single word against RSS. He doesn't, everybody knows that it is a violence led by RSS goons. It is not a spontaneous protest of believers and devotees.
Right.
In fact, Sabarimala is the most peaceful place. On the hand, in the entire state, in every town, a very planned manner, violence has been let loose.
But Mr. Isaac, now, can I just ask
instead of condemning this violence.
Yes.
Yeah.
No, you're saying the opposition leader is not condemning. He's actually critiquing your actions. But can I just ask you that the accusation is that you are also playing politics, that you somehow staged the entry of these women into the temple, that these women are essentially left activists who the government sort of engineered to enter the temple and then videograph the whole thing.
Well, government, see, for CPIM, I mean, do you doubt that if we give a call, there will be thousands and thousands who will link to march to Sabarimala? But that's not our program here.
No, the two
we
women.
We are not a party who have been appealing to enter, come to Sabarimala, enter the temple.
No, the two women who entered.
Under the Supreme Court judgment, if, yeah.
No, I'm saying just
now
about.
Now two women entered.
Yes.
Now you want us to have a blue litmus test whether they are true believers or they are activists, their background, and only non-activist background believers can be protected by the state. How can it be done?
Okay, so you're saying that it's impossible to filter these you know, whoever wants to visit. But in the violence itself, we've had one BJP leader or worker who's been killed. I believe that four or three other BJP workers were also attacked or stabbed in another set of clashes. So how do you respond to this? Because the BJP says that this is happening at the hands of CPM cadre, CPM workers. Are you not able to control your own party men?
Say you have hundreds of hours of footage in the TV, which has become. You take it and look who has been doing the violence. It's all recorded. And mind you, we are going to go through all these video recordings, identify the persons who have been involved in the violence, and book them.
Mm.
And that we are going to do systematically. And now the unfortunate event, occurrence has occurred. He has been hit by a stone. I don't know who's felt the stone. One has to investigate. Let police investigate, find out. We are not going to stand in the way.
Right.
But to say that it is a neutral, to clash between two parties is totally wrong. In the last two months, seven hartals have been called by BJP on the same issue.
Okay.
And they have been attacking every vehicle which is plying, every shop which is open. They have been inciting, violence. And if at all, somebody has come out against that violence, it's only kind of self-defense here.
But Mr. Isaac, what about the criticism that the state government did not really manage this entire business very well, that this was always going to be a central, a sensitive issue? That you did not engage in enough dialogue with all the stakeholders, with the temple authorities, with the other political parties, and that's what has led to this flashpoint.
Now we have been talking. In fact, that's mostly what we have done until very recently. We have been talking with everybody. But you must understand one thing. All these stakeholders have been party to the court case in the Supreme Court and Tantri, the so-called Raja of Pandalam, all these people have lost the case in Supreme Court. And they are duty bound by what the court has decided. We didn't go to the court. We didn't appeal against the verdict of the High Court. It was, in fact, women suspected to be sympathizers of RSS. Who appealed in the Supreme Court. And all these people were party to that case. And court has given a verdict. They are supposed to abide by that.
But you've spoken to them.
What am I to do?
You've spoken to the temple authorities?
The entry of women until an appropriate occasion comes.
You've tried to dialogue with the BJP? Have you tried to dialogue with the temple authorities, with the Congress? Have you tried to
dialogue with them? We called all party meeting. We called the all party meeting. What is the dialogue to be? Dialogue is how you can ensure the verdict is implemented. And we are committed in the court,
right?
The government of Kerala. Government of Kerala said, now this is a matter of faith and belief and tradition.
Hmm.
Therefore, court look into that aspect also, bring in religious leaders, discuss with them, etc.
Right.
But once you take the decision, that decision we will implement. Our position is that women should enter. They have equal rights.
Hmm.
But court should also look into the fact that it's a matter of faith and so on. And court decided. Once it is decided,
okay,
state
but if
government
you...
is known over to mediate.
Okay, Mr. Isaac.
Viable media is to be found. We will implement.
Mr. Isaac, let me ask you in conclusion that, you know, it's of course one thing to say that a lot of the protests and a lot of the agitation is being engineered by the BJP and the RSS. But you also concede that there could be a substantial chunk of public sentiment that is deeply uncomfortable with the Supreme Court verdict and with the entry of women into Sabarimala, including women themselves. And how would you handle that? Politically also.
Yes.
Because you may, this could also damage you politically.
No, politically, this is the way. In fact, I think, yes, politically, I think what has happened is Kerala should be a case study of, social engineering. We have initiated a movement from below. We know this is not an issue where you are going to settle with the force and the police. On the other hand, the battle is for the mind of the people. Therefore, we built a narrative around the Kerala Renaissance, how obscure our state was about 50 years back, how we have moved forward by breaking the traditions and
right.
so on. And we built up a narrative on that, we have a big dialogue. Brought at least 50 lakh women onto the street to line up. Then only.
So that was organized by you.
The two women who went there were allowed to go into the temple.
No, the women's wall. That women's wall.
We didn't organize. We attempted number of times, but we are not going to use force in Sabarimala to ensure that women enter the temple. No, we didn't do that.
Okay.
But on the other hand, we spend our energy and time to mobilize people in the street, and that created an environment in Kerala to accept it, and BJP is not willing to accept it. That's why they are going to violence.
Okay,
and
well,
that violence is not going to pay them politically. We know that they're going to get even more isolated from Kerala.
All right. Okay. Well, we'll of course have to see how the politics of this unfolds. But thank you very much indeed for joining us on NDTV. Thanks very much indeed. So, Thomas Isaac there. Let me just go straight across now to Dr. Vamanacharya, leader of the BJP, who's been waiting patiently, as is MB Rajesh, Lok Sabha MP of the CPM, and Meghna Pant, author and activist, also with us. The Congress has, and this is not for the first time, ducked out of debating this issue. They're not sending their spokespersons to debate Sabarimala. Dr. Vamanacharya, to you, the point being that you are guilty of both double standards, as we just read out, when it comes to, triple talaq. We heard what your leader said, and then we saw what you did in Sabarimala. So clearly indications that this is simply about politics. As the Kerala finance minister is saying, you're simply trying to incite violence and hoping for political gain.
Srinivasan, you ask this question to Congress.
Hmm.
They have the double standard. At the center, they speak in one language.
Yes.
And when it comes to Kerala, they speak other language. Because in
I'd love to ask them,
Congress
but they're boycotting this subject.
Congress is aware that 90% of the people are with tradition. Keralites are very much for tradition, number one. Number two, take the issue one by one. Take the issue of communists. Communists specially went to the court, made this judgment to happen, came back, and 2 days back, they sorted that
the
two women enter into the temple. This is against, it is against the wish of the people there.
Okay.
Number three, I'll come.
Take
the other communities.
No, before you go to number three, because you know this has to be a discussion, allow me to be interactive here. When you talk of double standards, hold on. When you talk of double standards, here's an example of double standards. When it came to the Shani temple in Maharashtra. Let's put up that graphic on the screen. When it came to the Shani Shingnapur temple, where again there was the question of women not being allowed to enter that temple because of the tradition, there we had the Chief Minister of Maharashtra saying that women have always been given the freedom to worship, and he supported the entry of women into that temple. So in BJP run Maharashtra, it's fine, but in left run Kerala, the BJP has a problem.
Yeah. I'll come to that point.
Respond to Shani Shingnapur and Devendra Fadnavis's position on that.
Yeah. When it came to Shani Shingnapur in Maharashtra,
yes,
the issue was that people there were not objecting that strongly. Here it is a tradition in Kerala that people themselves do not want this.
The locals in Maharashtra opposed it strongly. Repeated attempts were made. The women could not enter. Finally, it was done through mediation and negotiation. Sri Ravi Shankar was involved.
Yes.
The Varkari Samaj was involved.
Yes. Not.
But it is wrong to say that the people there didn't oppose it. And ultimately, what I'm asking you about is your position. Because your own chief minister there said women's right to access religious tradition, temples, trumps or overrides tradition. So, it's just clear. In Maharashtra, but not here. Can I just get Meghna Panth in?
I'll come to that point. See, if somebody can come together, discuss this issue, and if people of Kerala, by and large, accept this, as political party, we cannot have an objection for this. Why are you hurting people of Karnataka?
Okay, let me go
number
to
number two, three is I was going through the points.
Okay, let me just come back to you.
I'll just finish few more points.
No. Just a second. I have to go to the others also. We have very little time because you said that why not through dialogue? Finance Minister of Kerala says all he's been doing is dialoguing. Meghna Panth, no political party is emerging with their hands clean on this, particularly the two national parties.
It's such a travesty of justice, you know, Srinivas. We're seeing, first of all, it's unconstitutional, it's arbitrary, it's illegal. People keep waking up the issue of tradition. They're forgetting that even in King Travancore's time, in the 18th century, women were allowed into this temple. Mm. It had only been upheld till 1991, first of all. Second of all, it's not just about religion, but also about female autonomy. The fact is women have a right to pray when and if they choose to, wherever they choose to. So it's impinging on female autonomy as well. And the fact is that it's also impinging on Article 15, 16, 17 and 25 of the Constitution.
Yes.
So when it's the law of the land, when it's the faith of the women that's taking them into the temple, who are these so-called devotees, you know? They're basically goons in the guise of devotees who are threatening physical violence against these women and preventing them from entering the temple where they're actually legally allowed to enter. So my entire point is that how are they any different from, say, rapists who inflict physical violence onto women in order to suppress them and to dehumanize them? How is this any different?
MB Rajesh, if I have you back on.
Yes.
Sorry, we were just trying to get your line up properly. Yeah. What do you, MB Rajesh, make of the fact that, as Dr. Vamanacharya says, that this is a left government that is out of sync with the popular mood? You're enforcing these, you know, the law, but you're doing so at the cost of popular sentiment, and you're hurting the sentiment of millions of believers in Kerala.
The left government is discharging its constitutional obligation of implementing the verdict given by the Constitutional Bench of Supreme Court of India.
Mm.
And we will not shy away from discharging that constitutional responsibility.
Right.
Secondly, both Congress and BJP, both are culprits of double standards. BJP is not only culprit of double standards on Mutalak and Sabarimala. On Sabarimala itself, they have taken a U-turn.
Right.
Initially, now I have got the lead story of RSS mouthpiece in Kerala, Janmabhoomi. On 29 September, Janmabhoomi's lead story was hailing Supreme Court judgment on Sabarimala. And RSS says we respect the Supreme Court judgment. Now all women are free to enter Sabarimala shrine. They were celebrating this verdict. And they said that they welcome it. Not only that, their General Secretary Bhaiyaji Joshi, he on record, he had welcomed this judgment. And he said that the Sabarimala temple authorities are bound to implement Supreme Court's judgment.
Right.
Then Congress AICC leadership termed the judgment as historic.
Yes.
Rahul Gandhi said he is for gender equality and he is for women's
I know we put that up all on the screen just now.
In Sabarimala temple.
Yes.
Then the See, I can show the Janmabhoomi newspaper.
Okay.
The RSS mouthpiece.
We've got that. Can I understood. Point understood. Point understood. Let me just go across to Deepa Rahul Ishwar, who's joined us just now, activist Voice to Save Sabarimala campaign. Deepa, do you agree with the CPM
Please allow me
view?
To complete.
Do you agree with the CPM view that this is a movement that has been hijacked by the BJP and RSS for its own political gains? One moment they're supporting the judgment and next minute they're going aggressively against it.
No, I think any move or any opinion which is in favor of the devotees, because I think here the majority is the devotees. I think we have larger number of devotees than number of people in BJP who change their stance. So I think the one person who one community that does not have any sort of double stance are devotees like me. So I think all of you are keeping in mind the BJP, the communists, and you know the different political parties, but you're forgetting the major people on around whom this temple is affecting, and that is devotees like me. Secondly, it's a little funny to hear them say that, you know, they have an obligation to implement the Supreme Court verdict, because I don't have to remind which are the other verdicts which have been very, very carefully discussed but not implemented by our state government. So I don't know why is it that they have a moral obligation only towards this particular Supreme Court verdict. So I think that's a very weak argument from the government point of view. We have been looking up to the government to help us out because
Deepa, what verdict is not being implemented?
I'm sure he would know about the Piravam church and also about the fact that, you know, the speaker has not been allowed for mosque.
Okay, let me get.
So I don't have to talk about it because, you know, that will take me into a political discussion.
No, but I just want to get MB Rajesh to hold on. Let me get MB Rajesh to quickly respond to that because I'm not fully studied this issue. But from what I understand, this is a case where, again, there's been a court ruling about a church.
This
is that again about the entry?
Standard.
Is that again about the entry of women and the government has not gone ahead and enforced that? MB Rajesh.
See, the comparison between Sabarimala verdict by the Constitutional Bench of Supreme Court and the verdict on Piravam church is completely misplaced. Number one,
See?
The Piravam case is a dispute, a property dispute between two factions, Jacobite and another faction.
So that's also the Supreme Court.
They approach Supreme Court. Please don't interrupt me.
Deepa, don't interrupt. He didn't interrupt you.
They approach Supreme Court for these RSS and BJP people approach Supreme Court for initiating contempt proceedings against the government of Kerala on Piravam Church case, and the Supreme Court has dismissed their plea, and Supreme Court has clarified that the government of Kerala is not a party to this Piravam Church case, and the government has nothing to do with it. And in Sabarimala case, government of Kerala is a party. Government is under a constitutional obligation.
Can I just get
her if she feels that it's funny. If she feels funny about constitutional obligation, I cannot comment on that.
Okay. No,
I
she's
feel
not.
Funny about
she's not
feeling.
She's not saying it's funny. But Meghna Pant, can I just ask you, Meghna Pant, that you know, one of the things that has been interesting to observe in the case of Sabarimala is that. And this is the argument being made by some of those who are opposing the entry of women, is that for whatever reason, unlike in Shani Shingnapur, there's not been a huge surge of women wanting to enter. And that therefore this idea that there are a lot of women who are waiting for this ban to be lifted has not happened. And so then the, again the argument that the majority sentiment is not in favor of temple entry. Is that a relevant argument at all?
There are 490. I think it's completely irrelevant. The fact is there are 497 million women in the country today. And I can safely say that most of them want to be allowed to pray wherever they wish to pray. It's a question of gender equality. It's a question of female autonomy. The fact is, women are not coming to the forefront because they are fearful. They are scared for their lives. Let's not forget the kind of physical violence that was inflicted on the women who did initially try to enter the temple immediately following the Supreme Court verdict. They were beaten up. They were threatened. And let's face it, in a country like ours, these threats are very, very serious. We see every 20 minutes in our country, a woman is raped. Threats of physical violence and sexual violence are very real issues in our country. If you're disbarred physically from entering the temple, how would you gather the courage?
Last word from you, Dr. Vamanacharya. The BJP is a national party. Surely you have to respect the constitution. Surely, Dr. Vamanacharya, you have to respect the rule of law.
Number one, Supreme Court should not have entered into this issue at all. Because now that it has, whether it is High Court or Supreme Court, should you respect it when it came to the talaq?
Why not there, this case? Very quickly.
There are sane voices which are saying that it should be reconsidered because religion is one thing where court should not enter.
Okay.
Tradition is one which goes on belief. It does not go on any law.
Triple talaq. They enter. You didn't have a problem. Okay, we'll have to leave it there.
Number two.
We don't have time for number two.
There are other issues.
We're out of time.
Only one sentence.
Out of time. I hate to cut you off, but we're completely out of time. You're right to say that you can challenge a legal verdict, but challenge it in court. Why in the streets and why with violence? That's all the time we have on Reality Check. Thanks so much for watching. Good night.